Hello everyone, I'm Tim McCurry with Red-D-Arc. I'm the welding automation specialist, and today I'm going to show you how to set up the Red-D-Arc FieldPro welding system with the FieldPro suitcase. So let's get started on what we have here. So we have the Red-D-Arc ArcReach welding power source, and we have the ArcReach suitcase feeder. What we need to do is we need to connect those components, and we're going to put everything together, and we're going to set it up and weld with our ARCAL force welding gas. First thing you need to do is you need to make sure you have a qualified electrician wire your unit and make sure it's working properly. Next, once the unit is wired, we can start opening the suitcase and going through the setup of the suitcase, adding the wire and some of the functions of the suitcase, as well as what we need to check on the inside. First thing I do is I remove the welding spool retainer and the volt sensing lead. This is a volt sensing lead which sends an electrical signal back to the drive unit to drive the wire. This is not a ground cable. This needs to be added to the work piece along with your ground cable that'll come from the ground machine, which we will cover in a little bit. You can let that hang there. The next thing I do is I check my drive rolls. My drive rolls are these round metal objects that will pinch the wire or put tension on the wire and drive the wire. These are set for 035. They have the 035 0.035 designation on them. That 035 faces out on the drive rolls. And what we do is we simply align them with the slots that are on there, slide it in, and lock it. There's one for the drive unit itself, and there's another one for the drive idler. Here we have the wire tensioner. The wire tensioner can be loosened or tightened accordingly. What that'll do is that'll put tension on the idler wheel, on the idler drive wheel, and that'll tension that and put more tension on that wire to drive that wire. Too much tension will end up making the wire slip. Too little tension will end up making the wire slip. So there's a happy medium to be set there. The other thing I check is I check the wire straightener. The wire straightener is a part of the system that when the wire feeds through, it straightens the wire between these two brass units. And what I do is I check to make sure that there's not marked up, gouged up, or defective in any way that could potentially give you an issue while feeding the wire. I tighten that back down with an Allen wrench, and once that's tight, I can add my spool of wire. So once we have our wire set, we need to align it with the spindle that's on the inside of the wire feeder, which has a stem that's sticking out of it that will correspond with the two holes that are in the wire. This wire happens to be a solid MIG welding wire. That solid MIG welding wire is used for both carbon steel and some other steels. What I will do now is I will remove the wire from the spool slightly. I will clip the bent part that's holding it, and I will feed it through the wire straightener underneath the brass piece of the wire straightener, and I will feed it out slightly through where the MIG welding gun or MIG welding torch will attach. I will then clamp down my wire feeder, and if I have to make any adjustments, I can make any adjustments. As well as what's inside this box is there is an on-off switch for the soft arc. There's also a switch for constant voltage and constant current. There is a trigger hold switch, and there is a purge for the gas and a jog for the wire. What you'll see me do in a little bit is I will use the jog button to feed the wire through the MIG torch. And now we're ready to power up our unit. Turn on the on switch. The system will start go through its own booting cycle to power up. I'm going to attach the ground cable The male end will go into the negative. The ground cable is going to come out here and rest for a second. The positive male end will go into the positive side. The female positive will go to the back of the feeder. So let's go through the setup of the machine. Now that the machine is completely turned on, we have a couple different options here on the front panel with this knob. It's currently set in gas metal arc welding, which would require another feeder to be put into this 14-pin outlet. Today we are going to do the suitcase, so we're not going to need that setting. The next one is still gas metal arc welding, but it's going to use the suitcase side of it. That'll be the setting we will come back to once we go through some of the other ones. We also have a no gas flux cord arc setting for use with the same type of wire feeder. The next one is a stick electrode setting for your 7018 or your light soft arc electrodes. The next one is your 6010 setting, which is for your pipe welding or your higher cellulose 10 series rods. The next one is carbon arc gouging, used for carbon arc gouging. The next one is TIG welding, and that is lift arc TIG. And the next one is remote TIG. So we're gonna go back to the gas metal arc flux cord arc welding setting that's on the FieldPro. Now that we're back at our setting, we're on our flux cord arc welding setting and our gas metal arc welding setting. Our wire feeder is off. I'm going to attach the volt sensing lead to the ground for this, just this time. Remember, the volt sensing lead is used to power the wire feeder. The ground is used to send the electrical current to the welding power source. This is not a ground, so I'm going to attach that to it for demonstration purposes only, and then I am going to turn on the wire feeder. The wire feeder is powering on, and it's sensing where it's sensing the power coming into it. The way that this system works is it works through an electrical path through your welding cable to power the unit as well as adjust your wire feed speed and your voltage. I'll cover more of that in a little bit. The next item we're going to put on is our welding torch. We're going to straighten this cable out as best as possible. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to feed the gun, the rear end of the gun. I'm going to check these O-rings first. There's two O-rings here. I'm going to check to make sure that they have a good seal on them and they're not broken or damaged. And I'm going to feed it through the little stem of wire that's coming out. I'm going to feed that in, and I'm going to tighten up the gun lock in here inside the feeder. I am then going to attach my trigger cable. And once I attach my trigger cable, I will have power to the torch. Now what I'm going to do is remove the nozzle and the tip. And in here, I'm going to, as I talked about before, I'm going to jog the spool and have the wire come through the gun that way. Now that the wire has come through the torch, I'm going to reinsert my tip and reconnect my nozzle. Some nozzles are push-on nozzles, some nozzles are screw-on nozzles. Once I am set with that, I can close the feeder, lock it down, and then what I can do is I can now turn it upright to show you the front display as we use it. So on the front display, the feedback that's given back through the welding cables, I'm able to adjust my voltage setting and my wire feed speed setting according to my parameters. What's great about this is I can also now travel 100 feet away and I can still be operational and working in a scissor lift or working in an elevated height away from my equipment without having to go back to the machine and adjust any settings. Now that we have the wire fed through, we're going to be ready to weld. One last component we need to do, we're going to hook up our gas and we're going to hook up to the ARCAL force gas. There's a connection in the back of the suitcase that corresponds with the gas hose. We're going to thread it in. We're going to tighten that down. The cylinder turns on very easily. There's an integrated flow meter already in this cylinder, so I have that preset to 35 cubic feet an hour. So when I pull my trigger, I hear gas coming out and I see wire pushing out. For flux-cored arc welding, which is a different type of wire than what we were using, there's a flux that is inside this wire, and in order to feed this wire properly, we have to have the correct drive rolls. These drive rolls have these serrations cut into them in order to grip the wire on the sides and not pinch the wire in order to draw it through. So it's very important that you have to change the drive rolls. Everything else stays the same in the gun. Once you change the drive rolls, you drop them in as we did before and lock it. Now we're ready to start feeding our wire through. When welding with Flux-cored, we need a different mix of gas. So we choose the ARCAL Flux, which is pretty much the primary gas for welding with Flux-cored wires. It's a different blend of gas that is specifically designed to weld with these types of flux wires. The majority of inner shield wires use a different type of polarity on the machine. That means we need to change these cables and reverse them. The positive will go to the negative and the negative will go to positive, but you should always check your wire manufacturer in order to see if that's what needs to be done for your specific wire when you weld with it. And now we're ready to install the gun. This is an inner shield torch gun. It looks a lot different than the one that we had before. This one does not use gas. And you can see the difference in the gooseneck is completely different, as well as this nozzle. This nozzle is made to keep the contact tip to work distance consistent. Has a type of a hand shield on it that protects the welder from sparks and heat, as well as some different components and a different makeup on the handle. Just remember, this is for no gas. So now that we've checked and verified everything and everything works, what we're gonna do now, I'm gonna get my PPE on, my welding jacket, my welding hood, and my welding gloves.